Jesus Christ died, we died with him. Though he slays me, yet will I trust in him.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome you this morning to Berean Bible Church. We're continuing our study in the book of Acts, and this morning looking at Paul's defense before the governor Felix. Now, in our previous studies, we've seen that Paul was arrested in Jerusalem. Now, you remember on his way to Jerusalem, he kept being told, don't go, you're going to be bound and you're going to be, you know, imprisoned in Jerusalem. And Paul said, I don't care. He was bound and determined to go. And one of the main reasons he wanted to go is he had an offering that he had taken from the Gentile churches that he wanted to deliver to the church in Jerusalem that was suffering. And I think Paul saw this as a real opportunity to bind this Jew and Gentile together in a sense of unity. And he brought Gentiles with him from these churches as representatives. And when he got to Jerusalem, he met with the elders and he was telling them all that God had done and all the Gentiles that had been saved. And they said, that's great, Brother Paul, but we've got a lot of Jews that have been saved too. And these Jews are zealous for the law. And they hear that, that you're teaching to forsake the law of Moses. Paul said, well, that's not true. So they said, you know, what you need to do to show that you're not doing this is we got some men who have taken a vow, go with them, you know, purify yourself, go into the temple. So Paul does this, and while he's in the temple performing the purification, some Jews from Asia see him and started a riot. They said, this guy brought Gentiles into the temple, which was an offense worthy of death. He didn't do that. They said he did. They went over, and they tried to beat Paul to death. Well, the Romans came in, saved the day, pulled Paul away. We're taking him back to the fortress Antonia when Paul asked to speak to the Jews. So again, he takes an opportunity after they just tried to stomp him to death. He takes the opportunity to share the gospel with them, to present Jesus Christ to them. And they're dead silent and listening to this man until he says that God sent him to the Gentiles. And then they start throwing dust in the air and tearing their clothes. And the Romans are like, what is going on? So they take him back to the Roman barracks. They find out, well, first he goes to before the Sanhedrin, and Paul gets the Sanhedrin divided over the issue of resurrection. So the Romans again take him away back to the barracks, and then they hear that there's an assassination plot where 40-plus Jews have determined not to eat or drink until they killed Paul. So he takes Paul, Claudius takes Paul down to Caesarea, and where he'll be safe, he'll be away from all this turmoil in Jerusalem, and he'll face the governor down there. So verse 33 says, when he had come to Caesarea and delivered the letter to the governor, they also presented Paul to him. So they deliver Paul to Caesarea, and this marked the beginning of his two-year imprisonment in Caesarea. He's there for 2 years in prison waiting for some kind of decision to be made. During this period, he gets to state his case. He gets to literally present the gospel to two provincial governors and to a king, which really fulfills one of the aspects of the Lord's calling when he called him. If you remember back in Acts 9, we studied that a little while ago. It says, but the Lord said, go, for he is a chosen instrument, speaking of Paul, to bear my name before the Gentiles, kings, and the sons of Israel. Now, the governor referred to here in Acts 23:33 is Felix. His full name was Marcus Antonius Felix. He was Roman governor of Judea from 52 to 58 AD. He's also known as Claudius Felix. What's really interesting about Felix is he began his life as a slave. But due to the fact that his brother gained a great deal of favor with Antonia, who was the mother of Claudius, the Roman emperor, he also gained his freedom as well. He was the first slave in history to become a governor of a Roman province. His behavior in Palestine increased the hatred of Rome by the Jews. Tacitus says of him that practicing every kind of cruelty and lust, he wielded royal power with the instincts of a slave. And of course he was, had been a slave, and that's why he said that. It was a direct jab at him. His method of exacting his will was by violence and crucifixions. He married 3 times, each time to royalty. His first wife was the granddaughter of Antony and Cleopatra. His present wife, which was his third wife, Drusilla, was a very beautiful Jewish and the daughter of Agrippa the First. She had been married to a young Syrian king, but Felix saw her shortly after the wedding and desired her. So through the services of a sorcerer from Cyprus, he prevailed on her to desert her husband and marry him in defiance of the law. This was very typical of the man. Tacitus says he believed that he could commit all kinds of enormities with impunity. Tacitus also said that he indulged in every kind of barbarity and lust. Kind of sounds like the politicians we have today, kind of. Under his procuratorship, hostility against Rome increased enormously, resulting in the expansion and the influence of the zealots. And he then reacted viciously against them by hunting them down ruthlessly and dealing with them with extreme cruelty. This simply produced a further reaction which resulted in general hatred and contempt of a huge increase in the number of assassins. Now you remember, these assassins were men who would mingle with the crowds and they had daggers into their cloaks and they would just go into the temple and stab people. Put the dagger back in their cloak and keep on walking. They would murder all the collaborators until no one in Jerusalem with political connections could feel safe. Well, this is Felix. This is the governor who he is before. Now, once Paul arrives in Caesarea, Felix says, I will give you a hearing after your accusers arrive. So, once he gets Paul, he says, okay, when your accusers get down here, we'll have this trial. We'll see what's going on. Now, this is where we left off last week. Now, the first 9 verses of chapter 24 are Luke's account of the accusations made against Paul by the Jews, by their lawyer. And then in verses 10 through 21 are Luke's account of Paul's defense. So let's start out in verse 1 here. It says, after 5 days, the high priest Ananias came down with some elders with an attorney named Tertullus, and they brought charges to the governor against Paul. Now, the importance attached to Paul here is seen that the high priest himself comes together with these leading elders and an advocate in order to try to charge Paul. I mean, they just hate this man, and they want to do anything they can to get rid of him. Ananias, you remember, is a corrupt high priest. He saw Paul as a threat, so he travels over 60 miles to present his charges to the Roman governor in hopes of having Paul put to death. Remember, Paul called him a whited wall and predicted judgment on him. So I imagine that's still festering. You know, when you have someone in power who doesn't get their way, it just festers until something happens. All right? You know, this whole thing would be really awkward for Ananias also, because he has to go 60-some miles and deal with a man who had been a mere slave. And I'm sure that kind of sat in his craw. I got to deal with this former slave, you know, is making decisions and telling us what's going to happen. Well, he has an attorney with him named Tertullus. He's probably a Hellenistic Jew in view of his Roman name, though he could have been a Roman Gentile, just maybe some attorney that they hired. Attorney here is from the Greek word rhetoros, and it means a lawyer who was especially skillful in oratory. Okay, we're going to see this guy's a good talker. This is the only time this word appears in the New Testament. Now, it says, after 5 days, this is calculated from the time when the trouble first began. From the time they grabbed Paul in the temple when he was getting beat up and they took him. We'll see that as we get to verse 11, because it's been 12 days in total altogether. Now, after arriving at Jerusalem, Paul meets with the church. Immediately spent a few days purifying. Then 5 days earlier, he'd been arrested by the Romans, making it 12 days in all. We'll see that as we get to verse 11. All right, here's Tertullus begins his speech. He says, after Paul had been summoned, Tertullus began to accuse him, saying to the governor, since we have through you attained much peace, and since by your providence reforms are being carried out for this nation, we acknowledge this in every way and everywhere, most excellent Felix, with all thankfulness. But that I may not weary you any further, I beg you to grant us by your kindness a brief hearing. So, doesn't it sound like a politician? See, things haven't changed all that much. Tertullus begins by engaging in a bit of nauseating flattery. He speaks of Felix as a wise, benevolent leader who skillfully brought peace and progress to the Jewish nation, since we have through you attained much peace. Now, we just looked at a little bit of history. Okay, with that knowledge of history, we know this statement is hypocritical and dishonest. He did everything but keep the peace. He stirred up trouble because of the way he treated people. He was no man of peace. The Jews had no high regard for him at all. According to Josephus, Felix assassinated Jonathan, the high priest, because he didn't like him. And that's what I mean. People in power, they get what they want, and if they don't, they seethe and they brood until they get it. I think that Tertullus praised Felix for being a peacemaker in preparation of his charge that Paul was a disturber of the peace. And, you know, he's kind of put all this thing together to sound real good. After the flattery, he begins his charges against Paul. He says, "We have found this man a real pest, and a fellow who stirs up dissension among the Jews throughout the world, a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. He even tried to desecrate the temple, and then we arrested him." Now, the first charge is that Paul's a real pest. This is interesting. This Greek word here is lemos, and it means a plague. Literally, the disease or pestilence. This guy's like a plague to the Roman Empire because he's always stirring up trouble, they're saying. And that's the idea. He's a revolutionary pest. He's a troublemaker. He's stirring up difficulties, causing riots all through the empire. Now, this lawyer knew that this would have an effect on this Roman judge because the Romans had this far-flung empire to administer, and one thing they didn't tolerate was disorder. Any uprising, any little spark could turn into a huge fire that'd be difficult to put out. So the Romans enforced a strict peace. They dealt with a very heavy hand with anyone that was a troublemaker. So he's coming right away and saying, "Hey, Paul's just a real pest. He is literally a plague in Rome, causing riots everywhere." Well, secondly, Paul was labeled as a religious radical. He says he's a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. In other words, he's a representative of a group of people who are illegally practicing religion in the Roman Empire. See, Rome recognized certain religions. They permitted certain religions. Judaism was permitted. But there were others that were illegal. Now, see, Rome saw Christianity as just a sect of Judaism. And so they just let it go. They didn't bother with them. But this was a serious charge because, you know, if he's starting religions that are illicit in the Roman Empire, then that's another charge that, you know, they can bring against him so they can get this man put to death. Well, the third charge leveled against Paul was that he was a sacrilegious fanatic. It says he even tried to desecrate the temple. Now, note, remember the Jews in Asia, they said Paul brought Gentiles into the temple? They're not saying that here. They're saying he tried to desecrate it. Notice they're backing up a little bit on their charge. Not that he brought Gentiles in. He tried to do it. He tried to profane the temple by bringing Gentiles in. This was a religious charge that started the riot, but it's also a political charge because the riot broke the peace of Rome. The Romans knew it was a very sacred precinct, the temple. Anything happened there could just inflame the whole nation. So that's why they were very quick to get down there and stop this riot when it started with Paul. So basically, Tertullus is saying that Paul is worthy of death on three different counts. Nevertheless, he says, let the procurator note, fierce as this fellow was and all the trouble this man caused, he says, we arrested him. Is that what they call it, arrest? Remember what they did in the temple? I mean, they just start beating him. They try to kill him. The whole crowd's on him, stomping him, punching him, trying to kill him. The Romans arrested him. They call that, we arrested him. No, you didn't arrest anybody. Now, if you're using the New American Standard Bible, you'll notice that the last part of verse 6 through the beginning of verse 8 are in brackets, okay? They got brackets around them, the New American Standard. That's because some of the older manuscripts don't have these words in them. Now, textual critics usually go by the older manuscripts being the best because as time goes on, they felt people added things, you know, took things out, whatever, so they count more on the older ones. So many textual critics view that these words are not part of the book of Acts, but they're certainly true. I mean, look at what they say. We wanted to judge him according to our own law. That's true, right? They wanted to stomp him to death. And their law permitted that. Anybody who took a Gentile into that temple could be killed on the spot, and the Gentile could be killed on the spot. He says, but Lysias, the commander, came along and with much violence took him out of our hands. Well, that's right. He just came in with a troop, took him away, all right? And ordering his accusers to come before you. That's all true. So whether you want to deal with the textual criticism or not, I'm just telling you that's why it's in brackets. Definitely happened. We know that's, you know, it just could be just redundant, but whatever. It's in there. All right. Verse 8 says, by examining him yourself concerning all these matters, you'll be able to ascertain that these things of which we accuse him. The Jews also joined in the attack, asserting that these things were so. Now, Tertullus basically says, Felix, we're so thankful that under your ruling hand, we're experiencing the season of peace in its various forms, but there's a fly in the ointment, Tertullus. He tells him, he says, Paul is a peacebreaker. So Felix, man, you're such a man of peace, you got to deal with this stuff. And basically he's saying, Felix, if you'll just examine him yourself in the correct manner, you'll discover that all we're saying is true. Check it out for yourself, you're bound to agree with us. Then the words of Tertullus were backed up by the Jews, that's the Jewish party who had come with him. All of Paul's accusers confirm Tertullus' charges. They're all saying, that's right, that's true, that's exactly what happened. They undoubtedly expected Felix to dispatch Paul quickly, since Felix had repeatedly crucified the leaders of uprising for disturbing the peace of Rome. So they just figured, he's going to, yep, just turn him over to us, we'll take care of him. Or put him to death yourself, whatever. Well, you know, Felix is not some newcomer to this situation. So he knows the Jews, and he's not so quick to make a move here. But what I want you to see here for a second is Paul is dragged before this court being falsely accused by the Jews. None of this stuff they're saying about him is true. He's not a pestilence. He's not a plague in the Roman Empire. He's not caused riot. He is trying to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. He's trying to bring eternal life to men, but they are fighting him furiously. And I want you to understand here that you can live a godly life. You can live a stellar Christian life and still be accused of doing things you've never done by people who don't like you simply because you are a Christian, simply because you blow the standard for the rest of them by the way you live and conduct yourself. It is not uncommon for Christians to be falsely accused. The scriptures are full of stories like that, people being falsely accused. For example, Joseph. Joseph's minding his own business in Potiphar's house, taking care of everything. And Potiphar's wife approaches him, you know, trying to sexually have a relationship with him. And Joseph's like, hey, just leave me alone, leave me alone. He avoids it. And finally, she can't stand it anymore. She grabs a hold of him. So he just leaves his coat and runs. And, of course, she's mad about that. So she blames him and says that, tells her husband he tried to rape her. So her husband takes him and has him thrown in jail. Falsely accused. I mean, this guy went through some serious stuff, you know. His brothers hate him. 10 of his brothers decide to kill him. Then they said, no, let's not kill him. Let's sell him into slavery. So he knows his brothers can't stand him. Now, again, he's falsely accused. He'd have never made it through the situations he faced if he hadn't had a trust in God, even though he didn't understand. I don't think he had a clue he was going to be the prime minister of Egypt someday. He didn't know that. He just knew my life goes from bad to worse. Falsely accused. How about Daniel? Daniel was falsely accused in Babylon. He was faithful to the Persian king Darius. But two leaders, they didn't like him. And you remember what they said? They said, if we're going to find anything wrong with Daniel, how do we do it? It's got to be with his religion. Because this guy is just on the ball. So they couldn't find anything to blame him for. It had to be with his religion. So I know, we'll make a decree that no one can pray to any other god. You know, and so Daniel, of course, once the law was enacted, he still prayed to God as he always had. And they knew he would do that. So the innocent prophet is arrested, he's charged, and thrown in the lion's den. And it's interesting, he's thrown in the lion's den, and it's the king who can't sleep. Daniel sleeps just fine. And the king's up first thing in the morning because the king didn't want that to happen to Daniel because he had respect for this man. But again, when you're doing what you should do and people like you and respect you, others are going to hate you and falsely accuse you. And they had to find something about his religion because there was nothing in Daniel, nothing wrong. And then there's Jesus. The Jewish leaders repeatedly tried to set traps for him, tried to catch him breaking some law so they could have him killed, and finally they put him to death on false charges. Jesus, he's going through life healing people, raising the dead, feeding people, caring for people. That's all he's doing. And they hate him. They want him dead. So being a Christian who lives a godly life doesn't mean you're not going to be falsely accused. And if you are, the way to respond is to trust in God. He's in control. He's in control of every situation. He's in control of that situation. If you're being falsely accused, there is a reason for it. We see as we look back a reason for Joseph being accused. It was all part of his progress to the throne. We see the same thing in the life of Daniel. And we definitely see the same thing in the life of Jesus. You know, there we see the benefits of all this stuff as we look back. In our own lives, it's not so easy to see that. All right, now let's turn to Paul's turn in verses 10 through 21. Paul defends himself. Paul doesn't bring any other lawyer. He's a good orator. He can defend himself. It says, when the governor had nodded for him to speak, in other words, okay, there's the accusations. Now it's your turn. Paul responded, knowing that for many years you have been a judge to this nation, I cheerfully make my defense. You like Paul's introduction? Short, truthful. Doesn't go on and, you know, doesn't say anything flattering or, you know, that's not the truth here. He literally was grateful, I think, to stand trial before Felix because Felix was a man of considerable experience in dealing with the nation. He wasn't a novice. He wouldn't have been taken in by these fancy words of Tertullus or by impassioned by the opponents. Felix knew these Jews and the issues that were really at stake. Thus, Paul could gladly state his case before this official. He goes, look, you know what you're doing, and I'm thankful that I can come before you. So Paul just lays the truth out. Now, against the charge of being a real pest, a revolutionary, a troublemaker, stirring up difficulties and riots through the empire, Paul says, since you can take note of the fact that no more than 12 days ago, I went up to Jerusalem to worship. What's that got to do with it? He's being called a revolutionary, an insurrectionist. He says, I only got to Jerusalem 12 days ago. I've been here for 5 days. You know, that's not enough time to do anything. That's not enough time to stir up trouble. It's not enough time to get anybody mad hardly in that short of time. I'm not there to do that. It's obvious the apostle didn't have time to raise sedition against the empire. So the apostle simply pleads there's insufficient time for this charge of sedition. He said, neither in the temple, nor in the synagogue, nor in the city itself did they find me carrying on a discussion with anyone or causing a riot. Now that's interesting. They didn't find Paul anywhere carrying on a discussion. And that's true, right? When he got to Jerusalem that time, we didn't see him preaching in the synagogues. We didn't see him preaching in the temple. No, he had a couple chances to speak, and he spoke after they had already arrested him. So there was no evidence to support this charge against him at all. He says, nor can they prove to you the charges which they now accuse me. It was a case of words without evidence. Not a single genuine witness had been produced. Their case was all generalities and accusations, no facts. But Paul rebutted the second charge of being ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes by explaining that his beliefs harmonized with the Hebrew Scriptures. This would have helped Felix to see that the real conflict between Paul and these Jews was religious, not political at all. Paul says, but this I admit to you, that according to the way, which they call a sect, now they call it the sect of the Nazarenes, he calls it the way. Christianity was known as the way. He says, I do serve the God of our fathers, believing everything that is in accordance with the law and that is written in the prophets, having a hope in God, which these men cherish themselves, that there shall certainly be a resurrection of both the righteous and the wicked. So Paul says he belonged to the way, which they called a sect. But this didn't make him a bad Jew, for in the way he served, he says, the God of our fathers. This is a historic title for the God of Israel. Paul still worshiped the God of Israel, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He hadn't forsaken him. That's who he's worshiping. The Jews seem to suggest that the reason why Paul's ministry was so volatile and led to such violence was because he's not a true Jew. He's opposed to Judaism. So Paul goes on to say that he believed everything that in accordance with the law and that is written in the prophets. Now, how do you accuse him of heresy when he says, I believe everything in there? If you speak of the Nazarenes as a sect or party, you must say that this party accepts the teaching of the Hebrew Scriptures as you know them. He believes all of it. Every bit of it, Paul says, I believe. Now, these Jews should have been siding with Paul now, not opposing him. Paul says he had a hope in God. What's his hope? It's the resurrection. There shall certainly be a resurrection of both the righteous and the wicked. Now, the traditional hope of the Jews was the resurrection. Did the Hebrew Scriptures teach resurrection? Absolutely. That's why it was the hope of Israel. It can be found in Isaiah 26, Job 19, Daniel 12, Ezekiel 37, and elsewhere. Abraham, who was the father of the faithful, believed in a resurrection, didn't he? Well, Hebrews tells us he did. He was willing to sacrifice his son Isaac. He says he considered that God is able to raise him from the dead. So Abraham believed in resurrection. That's Paul's hope. That's what he's standing on. He says it was a hope. He says, which these men cherished themselves. Now, this is interesting. There must have been some Pharisees present. I don't think there were very many, though. We know that the Sadducees didn't believe in resurrection. And he says, I have a hope in God, which these men cherish, that there shall be a resurrection. So Paul here is claiming to be orthodox, while the Sadducees basically are the heretics. See, if there was a sect, it was the Sadducees, not Paul. He believed the Hebrew Scriptures. Now, you might wonder, how could the Sadducees avoid the teaching of the resurrection if it's taught in Isaiah and Job and Ezekiel and Daniel? Anybody know? Anybody got a guess? How did they say there's no resurrection if it's taught in the Scriptures? Okay, the Sadducees only believed in the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, all right? Which is really interesting. When Jesus engaged in an argument about the resurrection with the Sadducees in Matthew chapter 22, he says this, but regarding the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what was spoken to you by God? I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but the living. He's arguing here with the Sadducees about resurrection, and he quotes what? Exodus chapter 3. Because he knew they believed in Exodus. He couldn't go anywhere else because they only believed in the Torah. So he quotes Exodus, and he says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Indicating the reality of resurrection. God's not the God of dead people. The Sadducees denied what the Scripture taught. And I'm sure that the majority of Paul's accusers there were Sadducees. The high priest was a Sadducee. Probably most of the elders were Sadducees. But obviously there were some Pharisees there. They did believe in a resurrection. Because Paul says that, you know, some of you hold this. Now, the topic of resurrection again would have immediately caused an internal conflict with the Jewish leaders. That's what started the fight with the Sanhedrin back in Acts 23. Who were the real heretics? The high priests. The Sadducees were. They had ceased worshiping God because the only way to God at this time is through Jesus Christ. And Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth. No one comes to the Father but by me. They're claiming to have a relationship with God. Paul says, I'm the only one here who's not a heretic. They ceased believing in the law and the prophets. See, if they still had believed, they would have believed that Jesus was the Christ because Jesus is the topic of the law and the prophets. To deny Jesus as the Messiah is to deny the Hebrew Scriptures. Jesus said in John 5:39, "You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. It is these that testify about me." You search them, but you're missing the point. They're about me. They teach about me. Remember when he's on the road to Emmaus, Jesus showed how the Hebrew Scriptures taught about him? It says, "Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets," that's the Torah, the law, the prophets, "he explained to them the things concerning himself." He's walking along, and these guys, he meets these guys, and they're all rejected, and, "Oh, haven't you heard what happened? Are you a stranger around here? You don't know what happened. Well, they killed the Messiah. They killed," you know, and so he goes on and just said, "Let me tell you something." Takes them through the Scriptures and teaches them. If you believe the Hebrew Scriptures, you're going to believe in Jesus. And Paul's basically saying that Christianity here is true Judaism. They're the heretics because they don't worship the true God. They don't believe in the Scriptures. They don't believe in the resurrection. Look what Paul wrote in Romans. Strong scripture here. Romans 2:28 and 29. He says, "He is not a Jew who is one outwardly." That means those who are born Jews, those who are religious Jews. That's not what Judaism is about. And then he says this, just to make sure they get the point, "Nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh." I mean, the pride of Judaism was circumcision. He says that's not a physical thing either. Then he, watch what he says. "He is a Jew," here's true Judaism, "who is one inwardly. And circumcision is that which is of the heart by the Spirit, not by the letter, and his praise is not from men, but from God." The only true Jews in the world are believers. They're the only true Jews there are. The real Jews, they believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. They've had their heart circumcised. They are a Jew inwardly. He says in Romans 9:6, "But it is not as though the word of God has failed." You know, when God was turning his back on Israel, when God was judging Israel, people were saying, "Well, you know, I mean, they're his covenant people. How can God not keep his promises to them?" And he said, "It's not as the word of God failed." Here's the issue. They're not all Israel who are descended from Israel. What? Israel's not Israel. What do you mean it's not Israel? Well, physical Israel is not true Israel is basically what he's saying. They descended from Israel, but they're not Israel. See, the promises are the real, the true Israel. So we don't have to worry about those physical Jews. A true Jew is one who continues to worship and obey the true God because he came to him through Messiah, Jesus Christ. Paul writes to the Corinthians, "If anyone does not love the Lord, he is to be accursed." Accursed, devoted to destruction. So as Paul stood before Felix, he is saying that he was the only true Jew in the trial because he had come to believe Messiah. And once again, he makes it clear that any real disagreement is about what they taught, especially the doctrine of the resurrection. And he seeks to win his side to those side, those opponents who believe in resurrection. Anybody that, you know, holds the resurrection is obviously going to have to really side with him. Paul's here precisely because of the truth of resurrection. That's why he's on trial, he says. Now, we're going to come back to verse 15 in a minute or so. I want to finish Paul's defense and then come back and show you something real interesting in verse 15. He says, "In view of this, I also do my best to maintain always a blameless conscience before God and before men." In view of this, I think this refers to the way. In other words, being a member of the way results in men living conscience-controlled lives. We're not seditious. We're not heretics. We're obedient to the Scriptures. "Now, after several years, I came to bring alms to my nation and to present offerings." That's why he came to Jerusalem, not to cause trouble. "I came to bring alms, in which they found me occupied in the temple, having been purified without any crowd or uproar. But there were some Jews from Asia who ought to have been here to present before you and to make accusation if they should have anything against me." Paul, first of all, says, "Listen, I came to bring alms to the Jews." That's not the action of a revolutionary. That's not the action of an anti-Jew. These are the things a Jew does. "I came to bring to my country finances from the Gentiles." Then he says, notably absent are the Asian Jews who accused him in the first place. They're not there. Now, Roman law imposed very heavy penalties on accusers who abandoned their charges. You know, a lot of our system comes from the Roman judicial system, a lot of our system. And you couldn't just make false charges, oh, forget it, I cancel that charge. No, you can be arrested for that. You don't make a charge and back off. And the disappearance of accusers meant the withdrawal of the charge. So their absence suggested that they had nothing against him that would stand up in a court of law. They didn't even come down there. The very people who started all this. Or else let these men themselves tell what misdeed they found when I stood before the council. Other than this one statement which I shouted out while standing among them, that for the resurrection of the dead I'm on trial before you today. And so he refers back to the time when he stood before Ananias and he says, see if you can tell, see if you can point to anything that I did that was wrong during that time, except that I happened to cry out for the resurrection of the dead, I'm on trial. That blew the whole thing up. So in effect, Paul concludes with the real issue here is the resurrection. That's why he's on trial. We could say that Paul was on trial for his eschatology. All right? That's the resurrection. That's what he believes. That's what he is on trial for. Now let's talk about resurrection for a minute, because we have to understand what resurrection is to even get what Paul's talking about here. Let's go back to verse 15. Now, in verse 15, do you see the when of the resurrection in that verse? No, you don't. Because it's obscured in the New American Standard, and basically all the regular translations obscure it. But look at the Young's literal translation. You see a time of the resurrection then? A when? Paul says, there is about to be a resurrection. The words shall certainly are the Greek word mello. And whenever mello is in the present active indicative is combined with an infinitive, it's constantly translated about to be. Paul here is telling his first century audience that there is about to be a resurrection. Now, the Greek word mello here means about to, but it's never translated in the literal fashion by the major translations. I wonder why. You say, well, is that just, you know, someone's opinion about to? Well, it's a lot of people's opinions. Vine's Expository Dictionary of Greek Words on page 1038, Vine says mello's primary meaning as to be about to or do. It is used of purpose, certainty, compulsion. Thayer's Greek Lexicon on page 396 defines mello as to be about to do anything and to be at the point of doing or suffering something. Art Gingrich and Bauer, their Greek English lexicon defines mello as be on the point of, be about to. There's 110 places where mello is used in the Greek New Testament. And the majority of those places, in the context, it becomes seen that it has the meaning of something very soon to take place. It's about to happen. Now, I think that's significant that the major translations omit that. Biblically, the resurrection is to take place at the parousia of Christ and the judgment. Those are the big three. They all happen together. So if the resurrection was about to take place, then so was the parousia and the judgment, according to Paul. You know what? That's exactly what Jesus said. And he uses the same verb. In Matthew 16, 27, he says, the Son of Man is going to come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and will then recompense every man according to their deeds. Now, Vine translates mello here as the Son of Man is about to come. This verse is talking about the second coming in the judgment. At his coming, he's going to recompense every man. That's judgment. And he says it's about to come. How soon is it about to? Well, look at the next verse. Truly I say to you. Now, the you here is the disciples that he's talking to. He says that his coming will be before they all die. There's some of you that are standing here will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Some of you 12 are still going to be around when this happens. Now, if we're going to understand what Paul is saying about the resurrection, we need to understand audience relevance. All right? When he says here that there shall certainly be, or there is about to be a resurrection, who's he talking to? Me? You? A 21st century audience? Is it about to be for us? No. Who's he talking to? Felix? Tertullus? The elders? Everybody who's there listening? His audience. He's talking to first century people, and he says, there is about to be a resurrection. So if the timing of the resurrection was soon, what's it tell us about the nature of the resurrection? It must be spiritual. Time defines nature. It was to happen soon. We know it did happen. It must be spiritual. Now, what exactly does Paul mean by the resurrection? Well, the traditional view that is held by most of the church today is this. When a believer dies, their body goes into the grave and their spirit goes to heaven to be with the Lord. Right? That's what the view most people hold to. They are basically in a disembodied state, awaiting the resurrection at the end of time. But Paul said it was about to happen. Then at the end of the time, the Lord returns, resurrects all the decayed dead bodies of the saints, puts them back together, changes them, their physically resurrected bodies, into spiritually immortal bodies. That sound like what you've been taught? Sound like the normal teaching? That's basically what the church teaches about resurrection. But here's the question we have to answer. Is it what the Bible teaches about resurrection? Paul clearly taught that the resurrection was the hope of Israel. Look what he says in Acts 26. And now I am standing trial for the hope of the promise made by God to our fathers. God made a promise to the fathers. The promise to which our 12 tribes hope to attain as they earnestly serve God night and day. And for this hope, O king, I am being accused by the Jews. Why is it considered incredible among you people if God does raise the dead? Why is that so hard to believe? See, the hope of Israel, Paul clearly states here, was the resurrection. That was their hope. Now, the word resurrection does not appear in the Hebrew Scriptures, but the concept does. All right? And that's what we want to look at. For example, Daniel 12, many of those who sleep in the dust of the ground will awake, these to everlasting life, but the others to disgrace and everlasting contempt. Now, he doesn't use the word resurrection, but what's he talking about? Well, they're sleeping, that's death. They're going to arise, okay? They're going to awake to everlasting life. He says in verse 13, but as for you, go your way to the end. Then you will enter into rest and rise again for your allotted portion at the end of the age. Daniel, go away, go rest, you're going to die, and you're going to arise again. Again, resurrection is not used, but he's going to rise again for your allotted portion at the end of the age. Now here we see that the resurrection takes place at the end of the age. This was the very common Jewish belief. We see this in Martha's response to Jesus when her brother Lazarus had died. Jesus said to her, your brother will arise again. And Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Now, how'd she know that? Because it was taught throughout the Hebrew Scriptures. She knew Daniel. She knew at the last day, at the end, the resurrection would take place. It's going to take place on the last day. Now, our problem is we read these verses and we think the last day is the last day of planet Earth. But that's not at all what he's talking about. It can't be if Paul says the resurrection is about to take place. Let's look at the biblical view of resurrection. First of all, let me tell you what the Bible never says. The Bible does not use these terms. I know you're familiar with them. Resurrected body. It's not in Scripture. resurrection of the body. Again, not in the Scriptures. Physical resurrection, not in the Scriptures. You won't find any of those terms used in the Bible. Now, the church uses those terms a lot, but they're not in Scripture. And that's why I think we have to get in the habit when we're talking to somebody of when they say something that we don't understand or we don't believe, where is that found in Scripture? You know, I think often we're afraid to question people because we want them to think we know. It's like, oh yeah, I know where that Scripture's at. Well, it's not even a Scripture, so ask them. Where's that in the Bible? You know, what's the reference for that so I can look that up? And then watch them stumble. You know, don't be afraid to ask questions. Or when they say something, what do you mean by that? You know, have them qualify their terminology. You know, when they say, well, you just got to lay that at the foot of the cross. What do you mean by that? I mean, put that in something I can understand because I don't know what cross you're talking about or what I'm, you know, you're dealing with a problem. They say, just lay it at the foot of the cross. What does it mean? Tell me what that means in practical terms. Have them define their terms. Because the problem in Christianity, we use a lot of the same terms, but they have all different meanings, depending on our background, our religious influence. So the church is very familiar with these terms. They use the terms. The Bible doesn't. The phrase that the Bible does use are these. The resurrection of the dead and the resurrection from the dead. Those are biblical terms. So in order to understand resurrection, what do we need to understand first? From those two terms at the bottom, what do we need to understand if we're going to understand resurrection? We got to understand death. The resurrection is from the dead. That's what we're raised from. So what does it mean to be dead? We got to understand that. It's from the dead. To understand death, where do we go? If you want to understand what the concept of death is all about, where do you go? Let's go to Genesis. How about that? Wasn't that where it started? If we're going to understand death, we got to go back there, right? So let's go to Genesis. It says, then the Lord God formed man of the dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden toward the east in Eden, and there he placed the man whom he had formed. So after creating man, God placed him in the Garden of Eden and gave him a command, a beautiful, perfect environment, and he gives the man one command. Okay, just one. Here it is. Then the Lord God took the man and he put him in the Garden of Eden to cultivate and keep it. The Lord God commanded the man, saying, from any tree of the garden you may eat freely. Man, this place is loaded. Help yourself. Do whatever you want. But from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. Now, obviously, they knew what tree that was. Don't eat of that tree. Okay? Because the day you eat it, you're going to die. So don't eat from that tree. So God here warned Adam regarding the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Stay away from that tree. Don't eat that tree. You eat it, you're going to die. And the day you eat from it, you will surely die. Now, we know that Adam disobeyed God, and he ate of the tree. Genesis 3:6, when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate. And she gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. Now, let me ask you, did Adam die that day? Huh? He did. Okay. Did he die? Let me qualify that question. Did Adam die physically that day? No. But what did God say? In the day you eat of it, you will surely die. Well, he didn't die physically, right? Adam lived about 800 years beyond the time he ate that fruit. But God said he would die the day he ate it. And we know that God can't lie. And since Adam didn't die physically that day, we know that he did die spiritually. Why? God put him out of the garden. He separated him from the tree of life. He put angels with swords so he couldn't get back in there. He died spiritually. And people, spiritual death is separation from God. Separated from God. To be in God's presence is eternal life. To be out of God's presence is death. It's separation. And listen, that is man's problem. Spiritual death. We have a spiritual problem. Our problem is not physical, and the solution to our problem is not physical. Our problem is spiritual. We have been separated from God. Look what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:21. He says, "For since by a man," and that's Adam there, "came death." Adam brought death. We just saw that in Genesis. What death did he bring? It was a spiritual death, okay? A spiritual death. Because of Adam, all men born are born separated from God. Because of Adam. We all inherited that. He says, "For since by man came death," that's Adam and spiritual death, "by man also," who's that? That's Jesus. He's the second man, second Adam. "Also came the resurrection of the dead." And there's one of the terms we talk about, the resurrection of the dead. That is spiritual life. When Adam sinned, spiritual death came upon mankind. He was separated from God. And what man needed was to be brought back into the presence of God. So Jesus Christ came as the second Adam, lived a sinless life, died a substitutionary death, and therefore provides spiritual life, the resurrection of the dead. And that was the hope of Israel. Okay, because see, here's what we have to understand. I'm going to give you just a little brief here, and then we'll quit, and then we'll come back next week and pick this up on resurrection, because I want you to understand resurrection. It's fundamental you understand it. But to Israel, when they died, what did they think happened to them? I mean, you hear people talk today, what happens when a person dies? Oh, they're with Jesus. They're in a better place. Prior, that's true. That's very true right now. But it's only true because the Lord Jesus Christ returned. Because until Christ returned, no one could go into the presence of the Father. Nobody. And so people can go, but prior to Christ coming, when men died, they went to Sheol. They went to the grave and they awaited. And so everybody, righteous men, unrighteous men, when they died, they went to Sheol. And Sheol was basically a waiting place. I believe it was an unconscious state where they waited. What are they waiting for? They're waiting resurrection. And that's what Daniel said, this day is going to come and the just and the unjust are going to rise. So what resurrection was is Jesus Christ, when he returned, took the righteous dead out of Sheol and took them back where they belong, where? In the presence of God, which is life. So they were resurrected out of death, spiritual death, not physical. Listen, there's nothing in the Bible about bodies coming out of graves. That's a concept we have put on the Scripture that is not there. It is totally foreign to the Scriptures. Resurrection was moving from death to life. And remember in John, Jesus says, "I'm the resurrection and what? And the life." He's the resurrection to who? The dead ones. He's life to who? Those who are still alive. In other words, if we're alive, you and I who have trusted Christ, do we need a resurrection? We've already been resurrected. Your new birth was a resurrection. You went from death to life. Now you're alive. You are alive. You are in the presence of God. So death to a believer is simply dropping the physical and moving into eternity. I wish I could explain that more to you. I never will be able to in this life because the Bible doesn't explain it. The only thing the Bible tells me about heaven is that we'll be like the angels. That's incorporeal. We won't have a body. Do we need a body? I guess God doesn't have one. So, you know, God's a spirit. So what do we need a body in a spiritual realm? We won't. I know that's hard to grasp, okay? Don't think about it too long because we've never been outside the body, so we don't know how to function. But we will function just perfectly without the body. And I'll tell you right now that these three saints that died in the past week are with the Lord. They're not waiting on anything. They're enjoying fellowship with God in a spiritual sense that we can't even begin to comprehend. You don't need a body to be you. You're you. The body is just a house that holds you right now. Just like when you leave your house, it's still a house over there. Okay? You're not in it because you're the living presence of that house. And your spirit is your living presence. It goes into the presence of God. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you for loving us. I thank you for what you have provided for us. I pray that you would help us to be Bereans and grapple with this whole concept of resurrection, to get a good handle on it, Lord. I thank you for the truth, Lord, of the resurrection, that you have taken all those who have trusted you into the presence of God. And we also, Lord, at death, move into that realm, something we don't understand, but something we are assured of. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings, for your promises, Lord, to us, your children. In Jesus' name, amen.